Great job, Anna. You know, it is so wonderful. Yeah, y'all give her another hand. Miss Rita better look out, right? Thank you so much, Anna. I know that that takes a lot of time and a lot of practice, and I appreciate you giving that in service to the Lord. So thank you so much for doing that. All right. Good morning, church family. How we doing? Oh, come on now. Merry Christmas. There you go. You know, I'll be honest with you. I thought about it one day this week. You know, I'm probably like most of you. I'm not out and about a whole lot in the general public, but I've noticed this year, I really don't know that I've had anybody tell me Merry Christmas. Thank you, Ricky. So, you know, when you do make those quick little runs into the DG or wherever, just try to remember to say Merry Christmas. Because, you know, as the way things are going, it probably won't be much longer that will be politically incorrect. So anyway, just to remind folks, it's Christmas time. We need to be happy. We need to be celebrating. We need to remember the reason for the season, right? All right. Okay. All right. The first song we're going to do this morning, I want to read you just a little bit of the Christmas story. So y'all hang with me, okay? Says, and there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. Now, there's a couple things I want you to really hang on to me. Well, hang on when I get there. Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with an angel praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests. When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about. So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had seen and heard, which was just as had been told. What I want you to think about here is angels from the realms of glory worshiped. The shepherds in the fields worshiped. So you had from the highest to the lowest, they worshiped. God wants our worship. We need to worship. So I want you to invite you to stand this morning as we sing. Join in with us. And this has got a little bit of a new twist on a classic hymnal, but y'all get it, okay?
Oh, God is so good to us. It's good to see everybody here this morning. I tell you, it's just wonderful to be in the Lord's house. Today we got Brother Gary Pate. He's with Pate Ministries. He is a missionary to Ecuador. He's going to be sharing with us here in just a little while. I'm excited about him sharing with us here today. Before we get started with that, I want to share with you, we have just, 11 of us have just got back from mission trip late last night. Had a fantastic time. Matter of fact, we'll be reporting more on it next week. But I wanted to let you know we were able to minister to 35 families, 97 children. Just had a great time. As a matter of fact, we have got prayer needs. I guess we got prayer needs from every household, yes, didn't we? Things that they had going on, things that I'm going to get published to you where you can be praying over. I believe it. Church moves forward, fast is on its knees, amen? And I believe it through prayer we can, the greatest gift that we could give to them is our prayers. Just asking God to take care of them. But it's good to see you here this morning. I'm excited to be in the house of the Lord. Let's go to the Lord in prayer and we'll move forward. Heavenly Father, God, I indeed thank you for the day. I thank you for loving us and caring for us, God. I thank you for salvation, full and free. I thank you for this Christmas season, God, and what it all entails, God. Lord, I pray today, God, as we gather here in this house, I pray, God, that you would just be high and lifted up. I pray everything is said and done will glorify you. And, God, I pray for that one this morning that is struggling, that one is hurting, that one has got problems. God, I pray that they could find encouragement. I pray they could find peace that passes all understanding from you, God. And I ask you, God, just to let your Holy Spirit fill this place. And by the authority of your word, we bind Satan. Ask him, God, to be cast out. You do a work right now as only you can. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
All right. Our next song is The First Noel. But before we do it, I'm going to give y'all just a minute of fellowship. Y'all ready? Y'all know it's a whole new world, right? All right. you guys on the piano side, look to the guys on the organ side. Organ side, y'all look at them, all right? Give them the queen wave. All right. Some of y'all got to practice on your queen wave, just saying, okay? Air high five, maybe, okay? Let's give a little bit of that. There you go. All right, good job. All right, go ahead, brother.
To certain poor shepherds in fields as they lay, in fields where they lay keeping their sheep on a cold winter's night that was so deep.
I'm telling you, there's just something about Christmas. There's something about the birth of our Savior. And Brother Gary Pate is all about sharing with those in Ecuador about the birth of our Savior. You know, just in a minute, Brother Gary's going to come, but before then, we have a little short video that we'd like for you to watch. So if you would, go ahead and get that video started for us, if you could.
We keep doing the Bible clubs in places where we can meet and gather. But some of the villages have been more affected by COVID-19, and they told us that we can no longer have the Bible club on there. So we told them, what if we go by their houses and share with the little kids the baggie with the lesson on it. And they told us that that would be a great idea. So we started doing that, and we had an amazing response, because in some of the communities, we have up to 80 kids waiting for us by the side of the road. And a lot of them keep memorizing the scriptures.
Well, good morning, church. Thank you so much for allowing me to be here.
Good morning.
Thank you for that music. Thank you for that wonderful piano music, and thank you for the worship and the praise. This morning, man, I'm just so thankful Jesus is alive and well. I'm so thankful he died on the cross and shed his blood. I'm so thankful that he gave his life for me. But I'm thankful he's alive and well this morning at the right hand of the Father. Hey, and he's ever interceding on our behalf. And so no matter what we're facing or no matter what we're going through, man, God's in control. He's in charge. And I'm grateful to be here this morning. So please be praying for my wife. She's on her way back down to Ecuador. I'm leaving as soon as the service over this morning to go back to Ecuador myself. And we're just so honored to be here this morning. A little bit about my wife and I. We've been married 36 years. We lived in a little two red light town called Callahan, Florida. And so we're simple country folk. I mean, in other words, before we moved to Ecuador, we had a bunch of cows in our backyard. And so, in other words, we're just down-to-earth, simple people. And I say that this morning because as I stumble and stutter and forget what I want to say, I ask you to forgive me and overlook me. But Dina and I, 30 years ago, I took my first short-term mission trip. And someone may be saying this morning, what's a short-term mission trip? And that's where you did what Pastor and some of the folks did last week or the last few days, where you go either overseas or somewhere domestically, and you just share what Jesus has done for you. It's basically that simple. And so 30 years ago, I did that. I went down to Honduras, and on the way back, God began to deal with my heart about people that were less fortunate than I was. And when I say less fortunate, a lot of times, it's interesting, the first thing that comes to our mind is economically or financially. But I thought about the people that were spiritually poor, the people who really didn't know who Jesus was. And so I came home excited. I told my wife about my trip. We had two small children at the time. And the next year, she went on her first short-term mission trip. And I was in the business world at that time. I have to tell you this morning, I've never pastored a church. I've never been on staff at a church. I worked in the secular world. My wife was a nurse at a local hospital in Jacksonville, Florida. But we got 2 weeks of vacation every year. And we committed to giving one of those weeks almost every year to going on a missions trip. And then the other week, we would do whatever we wanted to. And so almost every year, we started going to another country and working. And we began to pray that God would use us in the capacity of full-time missions. And our kids got to be about 11 or 12. We started taking them with us because we wanted them to understand the passion that God had put in our hearts. And so moving forward 21 years after that first mission trip, it's 2010. We were down in Ecuador. We'd been to about 12 different countries by this time. And God just began to deal with our hearts about Ecuador. And on that particular trip, we would have normally been leading a team from a church, but we were by ourselves. And it was on that trip in 2010, I never will forget, I just heard that the Holy Spirit speak and say, now is the time. Now, I've never seen God in person. I've never heard God speak audibly. But you know when the Holy Spirit is speaking to your heart, you know it's the Lord. I mean, we can deny it or try not to pretend that we don't know it is, but we know it's the Lord speaking to our heart. And I told my wife, I said, Dina, I think after all these years of praying, keep in mind, we had been praying 21 years for God to use us. We'd gotten to a place where we felt like God really didn't want to use us in that capacity, even though we gave them missions and we prayed for missionaries and we went on mission trips. We just didn't think God wanted to use us in that capacity. But on that trip, God spoke to my heart. I told my wife, I said, Dina, I think God has given us the freedom to do this after all these years of praying. And you've probably prayed about something for a long time, and maybe God didn't give you an answer, but it doesn't always mean no. It just sometimes means not right now. And we came back to that little town of Callahan. We worked in Jacksonville. And over the next year, from 2010 to about 2012, we began to sell everything we owned. And the interesting thing about that is, I say this morning to no glory to myself, Because I understand this is the Lord's work. It's not my work. It's not Pate Ministries. This is the Lord's work. But we were at a point in our lives in 2010. Our kids were out of the house. We were empty nesters. We were making more money than we'd ever made. We didn't have any debt except the mortgage on our home. And it was at that time that God chose to say, now is the time. It was at a time in our life when it cost us the most, economically or financially. We sold everything we owned. We quit our jobs over the next year and a half. We raised enough money to go to language school. And folks, this morning, by the time I'm done, you'll know my English is bad and my Spanish is worse. But I'm telling you, folks, we went from living in a really 3,000-square-foot house to living in a 700-square-foot apartment. And all of a sudden, my wife and I, we found ourselves together, I mean, every second, every minute of every day. And, you know, she had no escape, man. And they say I'm hyper and wound up. And so, in other words, we were in language school. We didn't know the language. We had no church family like you had. We had no transportation. We walked everywhere we went. We were living in a different country. But God got us through that year of language school. And almost 7 years ago to date, to this month, we moved to Ecuador, where we live full time now. And we've been living in Ecuador for 7 years. And what we do, folks, is we work with children. Now listen, I've got two children of my own. They're in their 30s. And I've got two grandchildren, man, that I'd give my right leg for. I love those kids, but I never thought that I would be working with children. I mean, I had managed adults most of my life. But we moved down to Ecuador, and through a circumstance of events, God took us up into the southern Andes Mountains. We work at about 10,000 feet of elevation. And what we do is we work in 9 different villages with about 1,000 children a month. And these children that we work with, folks, they live up in the mountains. Most of them live in mud huts. Most of them do not have a refrigerator. Most of them do not have a stove. There's no stores where these children live. They just live way up in the mountains. They live off the land. They literally grow what they eat. And they have a cow that they milk in the morning and they milk in the night. And their lifestyle is more of survival than anything. They have no idea what it's like. For like you and I, we go to a store and we buy things for 3 or 4 days or however long we do that. They have no idea what that's like. They live for today. And if tomorrow comes, then tomorrow comes. Many of the children that we work with, we'll walk an hour to get to the Bible clubs that we do, because what we do is we drive an hour and a half from the city that we live in. We live in the third largest city in Ecuador. There's 700,000 people in the city that we live in. But we drive an hour and a half to 2 hours every day up into the mountains where the children live. And we go up there, and what we do is a Bible club, like a VBS discipleship program. And we get the children together, just like we're gathered this morning, and we teach them a Bible lesson. We have about 25 to 30 teams a year that come from different churches to work with us and help us. And if when that church comes, if they bring a team and they want to teach the Bible lesson, we let them teach the Bible lesson. But normally we teach them a Bible lesson and we play games with them. And after the Bible lesson, we will ask the children questions to see who was listening. And we give them a little prize if they know the answer. And then we do a craft with the children. And that craft will go along with the Bible lesson that we have shared with them. And we put a memory verse on that little craft. And if they take that home and they memorize it over the next week and they come back and they say that in front of their peers, we give them a little toy. And it's so amazing, Pastor, that 66% of these children that we work with week in and week out, day after day, memorize God's word. It's so amazing. Folks, I'm telling you, some mornings, if I can just be transparent, if I could be honest with you, I wake up some mornings, I look in the mirror, I'm in Ecuador, I'm brushing my teeth, and I'll say to myself, what in the world am I doing here? Because it's not an easy life. Again, we have no church family. We have no, our son and our daughter's not there. Our family's not there. It's just my wife and I and some Ecuadorians who work with us. And so it's not an easy life. But I think about these children that are memorizing God's word. I think about these children that are hiding God's word in their heart. And it's worth it all. You see, where we live, folks, I don't mean this in a negative way at all, so please hear me. But where we live, 98% of the people are Roman Catholic. And they're taught from the time they're born that they don't need to read the Bible. They're taught they don't need to pray to God. They're taught if they want to confess their sins, they go to a man. And what we do is we go into these villages day in and day out. And we meet with these children and we tell them that Jesus loves you. He died on the cross for you. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him can have eternal life. We teach them that you can read the Bible yourself. You can talk to God yourself. You can have a personal relationship with Christ. You see, they know who Jesus is in their head, but they don't know who Jesus is in their heart. And folks, we can have Jesus up here, but if we don't have him here, there's a big difference. Because when we got him in our heart, man, we act different. And we don't do what we used to do. We're a different person. The Bible says we're a new creature. And so that's our message to the children. We never condemn the priest. We never condemn Catholicism. We never condemn Mary. Listen, folks, where I live, day in and day out, Mary gets more respect than Jesus does. But we tell the children that they can have that personal relationship with Christ without condemning any of Catholicism. It's so interesting the way the Lord has opened doors. Because of this pandemic, we've had to do ministry a different way. You remember back when this thing first started, man, the churches closed and everything else. Well, in the country we live in, the people are very superstitious and very mystic-minded. And so the country said, you can't meet together anymore. So what we did was we started taking one of our little vans, like you saw in that video, and we started driving up into those mountains day in and day out. And we would put a Bible lesson in a craft, and we'd put a snack in a Ziploc bag or a plastic bag, and we would take it up there like you saw in the video, and we would give it to the children. And literally the children knew what day and time were coming because we go to the same villages every week, day in and day out, the same time. And we would drive up there, and the kids would come up to the van, and we would give them the Bible lesson in a bag, if you will. What we would do with them in person. The great part about that is they were able to take it home and perhaps share it with their mother, their father, or their siblings, because in Ecuador, many times, 8 or 10 people will just live in a little mud hut. So that was the positive part about it. We would go back the next week, and you saw that little girl walk up to the van window, and she would come up and say her memory verse, and we'd give her a little prize. So she was still learning God's word, and they were still learning God's word even in spite of that. What's so interesting is when this pandemic happened, all the public transportation shut down in Ecuador. Most people in Ecuador, they ride a public bus. It costs them 25 cents to ride a bus. The average salary in Ecuador is $367 a month. That's less than $400 a month. That's less than $5,000 a year for them to support their families. And that's for the people that have jobs. But the public transportation shut down. And we learned of these 6 little kids, little girl and her sibling, little brothers and sisters, who don't hardly have anything. And they took their little quarters that they earned or they got them somehow, and they pitched them together to make $1.50, and they hired a little taxi truck to take them up to the place where they could get a plastic bag with a Bible lesson, a craft, and a snack. And then they walked back home over an hour. And I think about these little children who had such a hunger for the work of the Lord, to learn more about Christ, that they would put their little quarters together to come up with $1.50 to hire a taxi truck to go up to a village an hour away and then walk back home just to get a little plastic bag. It's amazing the way the Lord's opened doors. Back in the beginning of this pandemic in March, we found out the governor in our city, he had these bags, if that's what you want to call them, of food. They were small. They didn't have a lot of food in them, but they had like rice and noodles and lentils and beans and things like that, that the Ecuadorians eat, staples more than anything. We found out the government had thousands of bags of these, and they just had them stacked up in the governor's office in the city that we live in, and they had no way to deliver them because they had no transportation. And so I got a hold of Andreas. We have 3 Ecuadorians that work with us full time. And these 3 Ecuadorians, we've been mentoring and discipling. And so the great part about this whole thing is that even though we've been here in the United States, Dina and I are residents of Ecuador. We're still citizens of the United States, but we're residents of Ecuador. We did not have to come back to the United States, but Ecuador went into such a tight lockdown when this pandemic hit that you could only go out one day a week. And you could only go to the grocery store, to the doctor, and only one person could go. So if this gentleman over here, if it was Monday and his day of week, he could go to the grocery store or doctor, but his wife or family couldn't go with him. And if you were caught out on the street, even in front of your house on the street, on a day that you were not supposed to be out, the first 2 times they find you, and the 3rd time they put you in jail. That's how serious the lockdown was. We thought we had it bad here, but it was really bad there. But we found out the governor had all this food, and so I got a hold of Andreas, one of our leaders. And I said, go to the governor's office and tell them that, hey, we have a couple of vehicles and we can help them deliver the food they've got stacked up in their office that they're not doing anything with. We found out, too, they had all the toilet paper. I don't know if you remember, they had a toilet paper shortage. But man, I'm telling you, they had walls of toilet paper. We have a YouTube channel. It's just Pate Ministries on YouTube. If you go there, there's a video that shows, I'm telling you, like millions of rolls of toilet paper. But we went to the governor's office. I had Andreas and say, hey, we can help you deliver this food. And the governor agreed to allow us to help him. And they sent 2 government officials from the government office to go with Andreas and our Ecuadorian team to deliver the food. But Pastor Man, the great part about this was they let us take these little food bags, which didn't consist of much, to our villages. They didn't say we had to go to where they wanted us to go. They let us go to our villages. And so it was a miracle that God just orchestrated that. But because we helped them, they gave us a special certificate to where we could drive every day. Otherwise, we would only been able to drive one day a week. So we were able to keep going to those Bible clubs and delivering those Bible lessons like you saw in that bag. Folks, there's so much to tell you this morning that I just don't have time to do it. And again, I get all tongue-tied, man, because I've got a million things going through my mind that I want to share with you. But I'm going to show you another video here in a minute. And in this video, you're going to see our three Ecuadorian team members. Folks, here's the great thing about this, man. I can't explain it, but it's so exciting that even while Dina and I have been stuck here in the States, and we've gone back a couple of times already, and I'm going back again today after the service. But the thing is the ministry has continued to go on. And so, in other words, even though Dean and I are here, God's allowed us through our Ecuadorian team to continue to share the gospel. The gospel's not stopped. There's a lot of missionaries that have had to come home and their work has ceased. But because we built a team up, God has allowed it to go on. You're going to meet that team in there. You're going to see a little girl that comes to one of our Bible clubs. And in her backpack, she's got a live chicken. Man, I'm telling you, when they come to our Bible clubs, they bring their chickens and their dogs and whatever else they want to bring, brother. Listen, we're no respecter of persons. They can bring what they want. We're just going to share the gospel with them. But I'll get you to start that in just a minute. But you're also going to see a gentleman in there named Gonzalo and his wife, Jenny, and his daughter, Jennifer. They live up in an area, folks, where we go every Wednesday. We drive 2 hours up in the mountains to where they live. And listen, folks, there are 13 villages within 30 minutes of where they live, and there's no evangelical church. There's Catholic churches within 100 yards of each other, but no evangelical presence. And we go up there every week, and we meet in a school, which we're not supposed to do. The government says it's against the law. But God has given us a relationship with the principal, and he lets us come there every Wednesday at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. And we've had 70 or 80 kids come from this village into this school where we meet, and we go in there and we share with them what I've already told you. But what's so interesting is that about a year and a half ago, this gentleman, Gonzalo and Jenny, we were able to bring them on as to be a part of Pate Ministries because they live up there. They're Ecuadorian, and now they're trying to reach out to those 13 villages within 30 minutes of where they live with the gospel. But folks, the ground is so hard. The ground is so hard there to reach people with the gospel of Christ because, again, I've already told you they've been brought up their whole life being told they don't need to read the Bible, they don't need to pray, that the priest will do that for them. They go to the priest to get him to forgive them of their sins or whatever. It would be like me trying to tell you this morning that what pastor teaches you every week or what you've been brought up to believe like I do as an evangelical Christian, it would be like me trying to convince you this morning that's not true. That's not real. If I came in here preaching something this morning or sharing something this morning other than what you've been taught or believed, you probably wouldn't listen to me. That's what those people are like up there. We're going in there telling them you can read the Bible, you can pray, you can have a relationship with Christ. But that's not what they've been taught all their life. And it's not a one and done, friend. It's not a dog and pony show. It's about building a relationship, and it's about loving on people, and it's about caring for people and getting them to listen to you and trust you and building a relationship. I think about some of the mission trips I did 30 years ago. Man, we'd go into a country. We'd be there for a week, and the missionary, the national, he'd get about 400 kids together. We would work with them day in and day out. But now that I live on the mission field and I see what really goes on, I think about those kids. And I think about whatever happened when I left. What happened when I came back to the United States? Did anybody follow up with them? Did anybody disciple them? Or was it like a dog and pony show because the gringos were coming? And folks, that's why we go day in and day out to the same villages, the same 9 villages, sharing the gospel over and over, just like you meet here every Sunday morning. It's not a one and done. You're going to see in this video where a couple years ago we started celebrating the children's birthdays. Every quarter we celebrate their birthdays. And folks, I'm not kidding you this morning when I tell you that when we started doing that, many of these children, some of them 10, 12, 14 years old, had never seen a birthday cake, never had a birthday cake. And so once a quarter we do their birthdays. We do a carnival once a year. It's like a trunk or treat, I guess. I don't know how else to describe it. But it's a little carnival where we have these little games. And I told my wife a couple of years ago, I said, I want to do this as a reward for the children. Keep in mind, these children, they walk an hour or so to come to our Bible clubs, and nobody's making them come. They're coming because they want to, and many of the younger children are bringing their little siblings. And I said to my wife, I want to do something to reward them. And so we put together this little yearly carnival where we have these games. And the city that we live in, I told you already, is a big city. And I was able to rent one of these bounce houses. And I'm not kidding you, the first time we took it up to some of these villages and we started blowing that thing up, the kids had never seen anything like it. They thought it was a UFO coming out of the ground. That particular week, we happened to have a team of young people from a church there, and those young people, they got in there and started bouncing around and jumping around, and of course, the kids figured it out, and it was Katie bar the door. But again, folks, we're just trying to love on children that, again, are very less fortunate than we are, but much more so spiritually than economically. And we're just trying to love on them and share the truth with them. And listen, we understand, Pastor and I was talking this morning, we can't save anybody. Man, our responsibility is just to share the gospel and love on people. Only the Holy Spirit can draw a person to salvation. Only the Holy Spirit can convict one of their sins. Only Jesus can save. And so, man, that's our message to the children, is that Jesus loves you. Well, I'm going to show you this little video, and you're going to see many of the clubs, many of the children in the video that I'm telling you about, and then I'll come back up and share a little bit more and close.
Give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord, it's your breath.
It's
a little boy saying his memory verse, 4 years old.
Jesús, ¿por qué tienen tan poca fe? Entonces se levantó y reprendió al viento y a las olas y de repente hubo una gran calma.
The children have a little fishing game, soccer, basketball, ring toss. They have a bounce house.
So we pour out our praise to you.
They said that it'll be used as an evangelistic tool for this community.
Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath.
I hope that gives you a little visual of what I'm trying to explain to you. You know, you saw in that video where there was a toilet and a sink just kind of laying out in the dirt. And a lot of the villages we go into, there's no evangelical church. But in some areas, there are some house churches. And when I say house churches, they're just concrete buildings. And a lot of the pastors that pastor these churches are bivocational. Many of them are uneducated. They've never been to seminary or Bible college. And so we started trying to encourage them and help the few believers by encouraging them that live there. But there's one place that we go on Tuesdays, and we've had up to 70 kids there. When we first started, we had about 20, and it kind of grew. But we meet literally like in the basement of a concrete block house on a dirt floor that's unlevel. And the thing is, they meet there weekly to have a church service like we're having this morning. And we go there every Tuesday to do a Bible club, but they didn't even have a bathroom. I mean, you had to go down the hill about 50 to 100 yards just to go to the bathroom. And so we were able to buy them a sink and a toilet. And man, they were happy to install it. We didn't even have to do the work. They were just happy that somebody helped them. But now that little house church has a toilet and a sink. You saw many of the children in the videos with backpacks and hats and gloves and rubber boots. We try every year to do something for the children from a humanitarian aid kind of perspective. But every time we give them something, we share the gospel with them. We make it a part that understanding them that, listen, we're not here to make you dependent on us, but we want to be a blessing to you. We want to help you. Because, folks, listen, I may offend somebody this morning, and if I do, I'm sorry, but I believe we can send people to hell with clothes on their back. I believe we can send people to hell with food in their stomach. And, folks, there's only, look, I depend on Jesus Christ to meet my needs and supply my needs. And our goal is to teach these people they've got to depend on Christ. Don't depend on some missionary or some human being. Hey, man, Jesus is a friend that sticks closer than a brother. And he's the one that meets and supplies my needs, not a church and not a man and not a woman, not my wife. God is the one that meets and supplies our needs. And so when we do something with these children to give them something, listen, at 10,000 feet of elevation at night, it's cold, man. We gave them boots a couple of years ago, Pastor, and to my North American ignorance, we gave them all a pair of boots. We paid about $8 a piece for them. But when we went to give them the boots, to my ignorance, they didn't even have any socks. These little kids take their shoes off and they don't have socks at 10,000 feet. And so we've bought several hundred pairs of socks to be able to give them some socks for their cold feet. So again, we're wanting to share with them and love on them, most importantly, the gospel of Jesus Christ, but also help them to be able to make life a little easier for them. You know, the thing is, my wife came up with this idea a couple years ago about these backpacks. And the kids, again, remember they live up in the mountains. There's no stores. For a mother, if she has the economic resources to buy what they need to go back to school with, she has to get on four different buses from that village to go to the city. And then she has to get on four buses to go back. It's an all-day affair. And so when my wife came up with this idea, why not give the children a little backpack with what they need to go back to school with? So we went to the government and we said, what do these kids need to go back to school with? The truth is, the kids that we work with, the government don't give a rip about. They're way up in the mountains, man. They get the worst teachers. They get the worst of everything. They're forgotten. And so we are fortunate that we have a lot of teams that come down and work with us every year, like I mentioned before. And so what we will do is, if we know a team is coming, we will say to this team or this church, would you like to buy the pencils? Would you like to buy the erasers? Would you like to buy the glue sticks? And we accumulate this stuff. And at the end of the day, we have about $15 in this backpack. And Pastor, we started putting a full Bible in there, a Spanish Bible, in the backpacks. Because we thought, man, if the children are told they don't need to read their Bible, they probably ain't got a Bible at home to read. Why do you need something if you ain't going to read it? And so we put a full Spanish Bible in there. And then last year, the Lord began to deal with me a little bit, and I started thinking about these children. Are they even reading that Bible? Can they even understand it? I mean, I'm telling you, I'm 58, and I have a hard time sometimes understanding it. And are these kids reading it? And so the Lord gave me this idea of giving them a little storybook Bible. And it goes from Genesis to Revelation, but it's in a Bible story format that little kids understand. And so we gave them these little blue storybook Bibles, and I wish I had one here this morning, but I packed light because I'm going to Ecuador today, but whatever. But we gave them these little blue storybook Bibles that was on their level. And I'm not kidding you, folks. When we give these backpacks out after the Bible lesson, we call each child by name. They come down. We make it a special, special deal. And I'm telling you, they are so excited, you would have thought you gave them a new pickup truck. And listen, their moms are excited too, because she didn't have to go to the city and spend a day to get what they needed to go back to school with. And Last year when we gave those backpacks out with these little blue storybook Bibles, the kids literally started applauding. They started clapping. It was weird. But I think they saw that there was something in there they could read and understand. And what we found out later was even the youth were reading these same little Bible story books because they felt it intriguing. And out of that, there was a little boy named Miguel. Just a few months ago, during this pandemic, he's 12 years old. His name is Miguel. He started having problems breathing. If you could get that third video ready. He started having problems breathing. So his mom took him to the hospital down in the city from up in the mountains. And he told his mom, he said, please bring that little blue storybook Bible. His mom went on to tell us that she reads this Bible to him every morning and every night. Keep in mind that a lot of the adults that we work with, friends, they can't read or write either. And so a lot of things that the children do, or that we do with the children, a lot of times the moms will come to our Bible club because in some cases they're on the same level as the children are. It's amazing that we'll have some moms that just like the color of glue and paste when it comes craft time. And anyways, but this little boy Miguel, he was having problems breathing. His mom took him to the hospital, and he said, bring that little Bible. And while he was in the hospital, his mom was reading the Bible to him. The doctor came in, and the doctor said to Miguel, 12 years old, he said, do you really believe what you're reading in that little Bible book? And Miguel said to him, I believe what I'm reading because I was told in my Bible club that I'm going to face giants in my life like David faced Goliath, but God is going to help me through my giants. And his mom started crying because she said, my 12-year-old boy has more faith than I do. I want you to see this little one-minute video, if you can play that, please.
This is the story of Miguelito Ramon, one of the almost 600 kids that got a backpack last year. We shared these backpacks with 12 different communities that we work and have a relationship with. Each backpack has school supplies, a towel, toothpaste, soap, and a couple socks. And the more important thing, a kid's Bible. We did the same thing on the coast, but in a smaller scale. Miguelito was having some breathing problems, and because of that, he was needed to be in the hospital during the pandemic. The only thing that he asked was for his Bible, because his mom reads him the Bible every single night. Early in the morning, an atheist doctor came and asked him, do you really believe in this? And he replied, yes, I was taught that I will face this problem in the same way that David faced Goliath. Miguelito's mom started crying because she said, this little boy has more faith than I do. After a couple days, he went back home with his mom and the little blue Bible. And like Gary always says, thank you, Jesus, for what are you doing here in the mountains of Ecuador?
So folks, God's alive and well. It's so interesting. I was telling Pastor, this past year we had planned to start going about 10 hours away from where we live. There's a bunch of fishing villages, just really poor fishing villages along the coast of Ecuador. And there's very little evangelical presence. And so God had put it in our hearts to sort of try to duplicate on the coast what we were doing in the mountains. And we were going to start trying to do that this year, and then the pandemic came. But part of what we're going to be doing this week when we go back over, when I go back to Ecuador, is we're going to start trying to set these Bible clubs up to start doing what we're doing in the mountains. And those little blue story Bible books are less than $6 a piece. They're like $5.60. Our goal is to give all the children on the coast where we do our Bible clubs one of those little blue Bibles. Because again, it's God's Word. And God's Word doesn't return void. And so again, that's one of our goals and challenges. And I've got my stopwatch going here, friends, so I've been going 33 minutes. If you'll just hang in here with me a couple of more minutes. I want to share something with you that I came across in my personal devotions here not too long ago. And I'm going to go through this really quick. We work with the indigenous people. They're called Quechua. All those children and people you saw in the video, most of them are what you call Quechua, indigenous people. And they learn by storytelling. And so I just want to tell you a story, but I want to encourage you this morning. Hopefully, that's my goal. And in John chapter 4, again, if you can check me out later, and I encourage you to make sure I'm telling you the truth. Don't believe what a man says, man. Read it for yourself. But in John chapter 4, Jesus is leaving Judea, and he's going to Galilee. Now, I Googled this, and I understand Google may not be right, but it says it's 93 miles. from Judea to Galilee. So Jesus is going that way. He had to go through this place called Samaria on the way. And he was tired from the long walk, and he sat by this well at noontime. And not long after that, this Samaritan woman came up to the well to draw water, and Jesus said to this woman, "Give me a drink, please." Jesus was alone. His disciples had gone into another little village to get something to eat. That would have been me. "Jesus, you go to the well and rest. I'm going to get something to eat. See you in a few minutes." But the disciples had gone to another little village. Jesus is sitting by this well. The woman was surprised, for Jews refused to have anything to do with Samaritans. So Jesus is a Jew. This woman's a Samaritan. Normally they don't have any interaction at all. And the woman says, "You are a Jew. I'm a Samaritan. Why are you asking me for a drink?" That's what she says to Jesus. She doesn't even know who Jesus is, really. Jesus said to her, "If you only knew the gift that God had for you and who you are speaking to, you would ask me for a drink and I would give you living water." That's what he said to the Samaritan woman. The woman looks at Jesus and said, "But sir, you ain't even got a rope. You ain't got a bucket. This well is deep. How in the world are you going to get water to give me a drink?" And Jesus said to her, "Anyone that drinks this water is going to thirst again. But if you drink the water I give you, you will never thirst again." The woman replied, "Sir, please give me this woman. Or I'm sorry, please, sir, give me this water." That's what the woman said to Jesus. And Jesus said to her, "Go get your husband." And the woman said to Jesus, "I don't have a husband." And Jesus said, "You're right, you don't have a husband. You've had five husbands, and the guy you're living with now, you're not married to." Folks, this woman was blown away. She met this guy for the first time that knew everything about her. And so, in verse 28 of John chapter 4, the woman left her water pot. Now listen, here's what normally happened. The women would go early in the morning to the well to draw the water. That's the cool of the day. These water pots were big, from my understanding. They're heavy. Women go early in the morning, the cool of the day, to get the water. This woman went at noontime. She went at noontime because she was embarrassed about her lifestyle. And so she didn't go with the other women in the morning. But Jesus knew what time she was coming to that well, man. And you know what, folks? Jesus knows where you're at this morning. And he knows what you're facing. And he knows what you're going through. And friends, hope has a name, and his name is Jesus. And love has a name, and his name is Jesus. And you know what, man? I don't know what's going to happen this afternoon, but Jesus does. I don't know what's going to happen next week or next year, but Jesus does. And part of my trusting him as a Christian is to have the faith to believe that he knows what's going to happen, and he's got it under control. And folks, the Bible says that all things work together for good. All things, not some of them, to those that love the Lord, serve the Lord, and are called according to his purpose. So if you're going through something today, if you're going through a valley, man, God knows where you're at. And he's there for you. He cares about you. Anyway, this woman, she runs back to the village where she's from. She doesn't walk. She doesn't skip. She doesn't hop. She runs back to the village. That's what it says in John 4:28. You can read it for yourself. And she tells everyone, "Come see this man who's told me everything I ever did." And you know what the people did in verse 30? In verse 39, they ran back to the well from the village. And many people believed. So my reason for sharing that story with you this morning is here. Here's the deal, folks. I never finished high school. I never went to college. I've never pastored a church. I am truly uneducated when it comes to book smart. If it weren't for common sense and street smart, I'd have no sense at all. But what I'm trying to tell you is God is not looking for your ability, but your availability. I can't believe still that God would use me in the little way that he's using me to tell children about Christ in another world. Listen, pastor knows this. I'm an independent missionary. My wife and I raise 100% of our support. Most mission organizations would not even accept us because I'd never been to college or pastored a church. I didn't even finish high school, much less go to college. And so we're independent missionaries. We raise 100% of our support. But what I'm trying to tell you this morning is maybe the Holy Spirit is speaking to you about doing something in this church or in your community. And maybe you've been giving God this excuse that you don't have the talents or the abilities, but God doesn't need that. He needs your availability. If you make yourself available to the Lord, man, he'll use you. And you know what, folks, listen, my dad died when I was 10 years old. I grew up so insecure, so scared. I lived in a single-wide mobile home trailer. And when those brushes at night, those limbs would brush against the side of that trailer, man, I thought somebody was trying to break in. I was so insecure. But you know what, folks? I can identify with people that's lost a loved one, a dad or a mom at 10 years old. I can identify with people who are insecure. That was me. It ain't me now. But you know, I've never been an alcoholic. I've never been a drug addict. I can't identify with those people. My point is this morning, we all have a story to tell. Listen, if Jesus Christ lives in your heart, he's forgiven you of your sins, you've got a story to tell. It doesn't matter. You could have been the best person ever, but the Bible says we're saved by faith through grace, not of works. So I don't care how good you are. The people in Ecuador think they go to heaven by being good. That's what they're taught. The truth is, folks, you have a story to tell. So, and listen, religion is garbage. A relationship with Jesus Christ, man, that's what we want to share. It's what Christ has done for us. And so I encourage you, share your story, tell your story, love on people, and just be a light and a witness. The other thing I want to encourage you about, and man, I tell you, I love your pastor. I love your pastor's heart, and I don't even know him that well, I'll be honest with you, but missions is not simply crossing the sea, but seeing the cross. Think about that. Missions is not simply crossing the sea, seeing the cross. They just did a mission trip up to the mountains. And folks, our mission field is our next door neighbor, people we work with, people we go to school with. Listen, folks, people got this big hole in their heart. You know what they try to fill it with? Drugs, alcohol, sex, all the things the world has to offer. And you know what? Let's don't be deceitful. Those things fill that void for a little while, but they don't last. Jesus is the only thing that will fill that void and last forever. And so, man, we've got the greatest story to tell that's ever been told. And that's that Jesus loves you and died on the cross for you. He's got a plan for your life. Hey, listen, I read here recently, I've been reading through Matthew, and in the first two parts of Matthew, John the Baptist says, repent of your sins, come to Jesus, because the kingdom of God is near. And Jesus says the same thing right in the next chapter. So folks, I mean, listen, man, we know the days we're living in. Folks, we don't have a racial issue. We don't have a political issue. What we got is a sin issue in this country. And if we would just turn to God and do what this Bible says, he says he'll save our land and heal our people. But hey, man, listen, God's in control. He's in charge. Well, I'm going to stop. Right down here on this front little pews and on this table, there's some brochures, and they just look like this, and there's a little recommendation from my pastor, Dr. Revis, who your pastor knows in Jacksonville. There's a prayer magnet inside it. So if you pick this up, if you're not careful, it'll fall out. But if you feel led to take one of these, put it on your refrigerator, and just each time you go to your refrigerator, pray for us, pray for these children, that they'll really come to know who Jesus Christ is. Also, we're on all the social media outlets. Listen, if I weren't doing what I'm doing, I wouldn't be on any of them, but because we are, I am. But we're on Facebook and Tweet and Instagram. We have a YouTube channel. We have a website called pateministries.org. We also send out a newsletter. Pastor, are you getting that? We send this out once a quarter. If you'd like to get this newsletter, there's some cards down here. Just fill this out completely, and we would love to send you this newsletter. We only send it out four times a year. And, you know, this morning, if the Holy Spirit is speaking to your heart about helping us, again, I told you we raise 100% of our support. If the Holy Spirit's speaking to you about helping us on a monthly basis, all the gifts are tax deductible, and no gift is too small. Folks, the only person that Jesus ever mentioned in the Bible about giving money was the lady that gave a mite. There's no Rockefellers in the Bible. And so, you know, again, I don't want your tithe. Your tithe belongs here, so don't send me your tithe. But if the Holy Spirit speaks to your heart, help us. I'd be so obliged. Please forgive me of going so long this morning. I'm so sorry. I want to leave you with one question. If you died in your sleep tonight and you didn't wake up in the morning, where would you spend eternity? You see, if I die in my sleep tonight and I don't wake up in the morning, there's not a second chance. The Bible says that we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. But while the wages of sin was death, the gift of God is eternal life. The Bible says, whosoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. So maybe this morning you don't know for sure where you would spend eternity if you died in your sleep. Maybe you used to serve the Lord and you've turned away. Listen, as pastor comes this morning, if you are not 100% sure of where you'd spend eternity, that is the most important question you can answer before you leave here today. Let me pray. Lord, thank you for pastor. Thank you for this church. God, thank you for allowing us all to be a part of your work. God, we are a team. God, not everybody's been called to go to another country, but there's people that can pray. There's people that can give. And God, I just pray your blessings on this church, on this pastor. And God, I just pray you would do exceeding and abundantly above what they think or ask according to the power that worketh in them. Lord, thank you for helping me this morning. Forgive me, Lord, of stumbling, stuttering all over the place. Thank you for your love, mercy, and grace. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Amen.
Christ, that's the most important thing. So, Christ the Savior is born.
Those backpacks cost you about $15 a piece.
Yes, sir.
That's what you're saying?
Yes, sir.
Did you say them little blue Bibles cost $6 a piece?
$5.60.
$6 a piece, right?
Yes, sir.
Old Southern boy, math, that adds up to $21, right? Well, God spoke to my heart. From Central Hatchie First Baptist Church, you'll get 100 of those backpacks next year. I want to hear the stories from more of Miguel's. If I'd have been going to preach this morning, I'd have preached out of Proverbs chapter 18, verse 10. In Proverbs 18:10 says this, "The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it, and they are safe."
Amen.
The name of the Lord Jesus Christ is the only place that we can be safe. The world is turning upside down. Our lives are being shaken. Miguel's life, I can't even imagine what it had been up till the time he cracked that little blue Bible. But Miguel, with his air that he was struggling for to breathe, short, he ran into the strong tower of Jesus Christ, and he was safe. I pray that each one of you can do that today. Today, on the way out, I just want to let everybody know, Brother, I'm going to ask you to come and stand by you by the table. We didn't give him a big table today, but we gave him a table. Amen. We'd like for him to come and stand. Maybe you want to speak to him or whatever. Brother Gary, I want to talk to you just a minute. I know you're in a hurry to go to the airport, but after we get done, we'll get things rolling for us. But I want you to have 100 of those to go to that new work that you're doing, and we'll get that all worked out. Brother Gary's asked me to do a point trip with him this upcoming year. I don't know what dates we'll get that worked out, but we're definitely going to do a point trip down to Ecuador with him to see about possibly maybe the next year leading a team from our church down there to be with them. Just wanted you to know, we have got a mission trip here locally coming up. As a matter of fact, it's right out in front of Howe's store. Thursday and Friday, we're going to be out there. We're working on Brother Casey. Brother Casey hadn't had a washer or a dryer, has no place in his house to put it. We're going to be building a room on and this week. Ricky's already started getting the stuff together. Brother Jerry asked me a year ago if I'll pay for the stuff, if y'all will put a new, through the labor and put a new roof on the house. And he cut Casey's rent to where Casey would be able to afford a few more things, and he's paying for the stuff. We're going to put the top on it. It's a mission work for our church, and I want to invite all of you to come out. We're going to be there. As a matter of fact, Ricky and I will be there. Where is Ricky at? Ricky's there. We're going to be Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. Me and you are, right? We're going to be there Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. Wednesday, we're getting up the materials. Thursday and Friday, we're going to be working. We'd love for you to come and be part of that. And also, where you'll know, We got other mission projects that's coming up this upcoming year. We're looking right now at putting together a mission trip to Alaska. I'm in the process of working on getting the details worked out on that. It's not come to fruition, but we're working on it. I'll let you know more about that. Thank you for being in the Lord's house this morning. God is an awesome God. Amen.
Amen.
Brother Gary, if you'll come stand right here, we're going to take a love offering in the plate. If you have a love offering to give to Brother Gary, the regular tithe, the tithe goes in the church, okay? So thank you for being here. Heavenly Father, God, I thank you for the day. I thank you for Brother Gary and Pate Ministries. I thank you, God, for the sweet Holy Spirit, God, that speaks to our heart. God, I pray that you would right now just continue to work in our lives, God, and until we meet together here again, if you tarry, you come and keep us safe in thy word. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Remember, we exiting over here out this door. Thank you for being here today.